Hello everybody, I'm Soprano and welcome to the Assassin's Bureau podcast. Today I'm joined by Red Hood.
Hello everyone.
And the Punisher, who I may also refer to as Adam during the podcast.
Hello.
Today we're going to be talking about Ubisoft Forward and giving our own thoughts, opinions and reactions to what we've seen. Just to get things started, what are your overall thoughts on the event itself?
I can just sum it up in two words. Optimistic, but cautious.
I have to say more a bit naive when it comes to Ubisoft Forward. I am super excited ever since the presentation. And I know I should be cautious, but I'm still keeping my hopes extremely high.
All right, that's bold. For me, I'm cautious, but I'm also quite happy with what I've seen. Let's begin with the reveal of Assassin's Creed Mirage. The things we do know about the game: set in Baghdad, 1861. Stars Basim as the main character. Most will know him from Assassin's Creed Valhalla. This game is going back to its roots and it's not an RPG. What is your thoughts on that, Adam?
As much as I like aspects of the RPG games, certain aspects, I'm more thrilled that it's not a RPG game, personally speaking.
Given that you've pretty much played both Odyssey and Valhalla, does that not affect your mindset in towards going back to the basics again?
Not really. If I'm honest, I've played the old and new games of around the same time, really. In the same year, to be honest. And I like the older ones better, mainly because of the quality of the story and the way the games were built. So okay, when the news hit me, oh, this is going to be about less RPG, I'm happy.
What about you, Red?
Yeah, to be honest, I'm actually really happy that they're going back to the traditional roots and leaving the RPG apart for this game, because it's a no-brainer. Like, the previous ACs, like AC2, the whole Ezio trilogy, and everything before Origins, personally for me, it was way better than the RPG style games. And so I'm extremely happy that they're going back to the traditional roots.
So you weren't particularly a fan of RPG?
Like, RPG, the genre, I was never a big fan of, but I always quite enjoyed it. But when they implemented it into the AC franchise, I thought it would be better. I thought I would enjoy it more than what actually happened, so a bit disappointed that they went in the direction and happy that they're going back.
In regards to it's back to roots, it's going back to its action-adventure narrative, no branching off. It'll focus on the three core aspects of Assassin's Creed, well, prior Assassin's Creed, which is stealth, parkour, and combat. Brand new, unique animations for assassinations.
Ah, sweet.
With the addition of being able to slow down time to perform multi-kills.
Oof.
But we got a hint of that in the tease when it was going from the bench kill.
Oh, absolutely.
A lot of slow motion during that sequence.
Yeah, it's basically like that. So I don't think it's going to be like how Odyssey did it. You know, when you'd zip across the map about 20 miles and then kill 10 different people.
Yeah.
It's going to be more cinematically done, I think, and there might be like a little mini game structure to it, or it might almost be like Red Dead Redemption's bullet time. So you mark your targets and then you just pull off the multi-kill. In regards to the assassination animations, what are you expecting, Adam?
Creative ones. What I mean by that is, like, do you guys remember the where in Unity, if you run assassinate a soldier, before sticking them with a hitting blade, Arno would kick the soldier in the shin, making the enemy flip, and then sticking him in the neck with the hitting blade.
Yeah,
unique kills like that, basically. Yeah, unique kills like that, like we saw in the trailer. The sword impales the soldier. He keeps the sword on that soldier, goes to the focuses on the other one, and then takes the sword back.
Yeah.
I'm like, hey, can you hold this, please? Thank you.
That reminded me of the Freedom Cry trailer that did, when it has the machete in one guy and blunderbusts to the other guy just at the same time. What about you, Red?
One thing I would like to come back is from, I think it was AC 3 and 4, where when like two guards attack you at the same time, you get like a little cinematic where you take down both of them when you counter.
I'm sure, just given the way the trailer was, there was a double assassination in that trailer.
Like, I love those cinematics. I really hope they would come back for this game, because it always gave me so much pleasure. I felt like such a badass.
Yeah. They are refocusing the attention on the assassins themselves, so it's not about other people, it's about the Order itself. And they are still currently known as the Hidden Ones during Mirage. Let's talk about the city, Baghdad. I have some information in regards to how it's going to be, and I would like to hear your thoughts on it. Building-wise, it's very close, it's very dense and vibrant, and it's specifically designed for parkour, much like the older cities.
Mm-hmm.
The corner swing and other familiar parkour animations are returning.
Yes.
But with also the addition of a new pole vault system to clear larger jumps.
That seems cool.
I'm actually curious about how that would work. Is that just something that's like already in place, or in the middle of your run, do you just pick up the pole? But I'd be curious to see how that works. And the streets are dense with NPCs similar to AC Unity.
Sweet. Hoping that they all look different and diverse. Unity kind of, they all wore the same color, if you know what I mean. They all looked like they said they were all the same NPC.
If they actually managed to bring back like the parkour mechanics of Unity into the like the dense city, I will be so happy.
There is interactable environments.
Mm.
So you'll be able to set traps and things like that. You'll be able to create diversions and whatnot within the city. But also, if you're in chase, you can cause things to collapse, like scaffolding.
Nah, like in the older games.
Yeah.
Like in the trailer.
Yeah.
You think it'll be like the Trace Breakers from multiplayer?
I think that's how it's going to work. I think you'll go through something and you'll be able to have the option to set it off at a button press while you're running through it. So overall, what are your impressions on Baghdad as a setting then, Adam?
A wonderful place. A wonderful location to go back to the roots, to be honest, because the assassins, both Assassin's Creed-wise and historic-wise, were not only in Masyaf, they were in Baghdad, they were in Iraq, they were in Iran. You know, it's a great way to expand on the Levantine assassins. I am thrilled that we're going to be playing as an assassin in Baghdad, in Iraq. Wonderful place to explore, play as, adventure, all of that. I can't even talk, I'm sorry.
It's the excitement, I know, it's okay. What about you, Red?
Well, actually, to be honest, I was quite surprised that they chose Baghdad as a setting, because you don't see a lot of games taking the Middle Eastern like setting for their games and stuff. And
unless it's Call of Duty. Like,
Yeah, but it's like sort of a different way, because for AC, I think in this one, it'll probably be like you discover the culture, how the city was. So I'm excited about it, because I don't know much about it, and from the trailer, the city looks stunning with how the cinematics were, all the buildings and the architecture, so thumbs up for me.
One of the things I liked about the trailer in general is I just generally enjoyed the familiarity of it all. The second I seen it, I knew I was going to like it straight away, because it's just a massive callback to AC1.
Yeah.
Just with colour.
Yeah, that's what I was about to say.
For me to be able to actually run around a city properly and not just be confined to open countrysides is so refreshing to me, because it's often one of the only reasons why I go back to some of the older games, is because I like traversing the rooftops of crazy city locations and exploring tombs and monuments and things, because it's all together, it's all part of the city that you're in. But when it's spread out like that of Odyssey and Valhalla, it's a lot of traveling. Okay, on additional details, this should finish off everything for Mirage. The main assassination missions are returning to Black Box, so we'll have full reign on how we want to approach our kills. And last but not least, the Eagle is back. but with a new twist on it, which I actually kind of like. Guards will be able to kill it. All right, and that's it for Mirage. That's going to release in 2023 and is available for pre-order right now, even though we've had no gameplay.
Yeah.
That is probably my only real con with it, because as much as I love the trailer,
what does this trailer represent? That's what you want to see.
Yeah, and it's because they're showing that trailer and already revealing pre-orders without actually seeing the game.
Mm.
That's probably my only con with that. I just think that's a bit shit. I mean, at least give us something.
Yeah.
Infinity. It is not a game. Infinity is a central hub of which they're going to implement future Assassin's Creed games. At the moment, as you've seen in the trailers, they introduced Codename Red and Codename Hexe into Infinity, because that they're going to be the first releases. It will have multiplayer included, which we're going to go over in a separate topic, and that's named Invictus. In terms of the concept as a central hub, which I will point out, I came up with this idea a few years ago. If you want to like check out the description, there's a link that will show you my idea. Having the idea of a central hub, which is basically the Animus, I think it's going to be like an Infinity software powered by the Animus. I think that's how they're going to do it in terms of a concept, because the loading screens is the Animus.
I like that.
Having a central hub where they're going to add games to it makes me wonder file sizes, because as we know, Codename Red is a full RPG. Hexe, I'm going to assume the same thing. But if that's the case, like, how big are these files to all be put into one section? Unless the games themselves just, they've gone for more of a smaller concept of an RPG, smaller world, but with more in it.
I think what they might be doing is sort of what, for example, Modern Warfare did with, like, separate all the different, like, campaign packages, multiplayer and stuff. Where, like, I think you'll be able to not install some of them to still have space.
That makes sense.
Like, for example, you can, like, download Codename Red, and then you can, like, take out Hexe to make more space for future games, or vice versa.
I genuinely think the size of these RPGs isn't going to be as big as, say, Valhalla. In terms of scale, I mean, like you know, one map in Valhalla is massive. So I do think the idea of shrinking down the map sizes to put more in it is potentially a very good idea, because you don't have to travel across vast amounts of countryside just to get a rare piece of armor. It's all going to be tight, close, and I would like an RPG that's more dense in terms of content, rather than just vast open landscapes where there's a cave in the middle of nowhere that you get one chest from. The overall idea of a hub for all these games, I've always been behind this since I came up with my version years ago for Assassin's Creed multiplayer, where I wanted the Animus as a game, and each time period would release essentially a pack that was set for skins and unique weapons, cosmetics and stuff like that for your characters and new maps. That's how I thought about it, and I feel like this is a larger equivalent of what I thought of, so I'm behind it anyway. What about you, Adam?
I can't really make a comment on it, to be honest. Like, nothing positive, nothing negative. I know nothing other than being a central hub for Assassin's Creed. I don't know if this is gonna work out for Ubisoft or not. Like, I can only comment on it when I've seen it perform, if you know what I mean.
That's fair, I suppose. All right, I think that pretty much covers Infinity, because there's not really a lot to go into in terms of that.
Still too early to tell.
They barely scratched the surface on what they want to reveal in regards to that, so there's not much to speak about it.
All right, moving on. Codename Invictus, the multiplayer aspect of Infinity. The points that I've got for this at the moment, it's really unusual. It's hard for me to kind of picture what it could be. It's going to be a standalone multiplayer, which is great. It's its own thing. Work of past heroes and a minotaur is representative of what we may experience, is something that I've heard.
Which puzzles me.
The way that looks to me is I feel like we're going to get more of like an open world multiplayer, and previous characters we've either played as or met, including villains and all that type of stuff.
So it would be more towards like co-op, the multiplayer co-op from Unity than the previous multiplayer type.
That's what it sounds like to me. And the one main point they've said is it's a creative intention to bridge the different AC games together in a multiplayer experience. So I do feel like it's going to be quite co-op driven, which given their track record on the previous co-op, I'm not exactly excited about that if that is the case. But the fact that it's a standalone multiplayer bodes well, because I feel like there's room for improvement and they should update it regularly. Because it'll have its own team and not just be a server on one of the other standalones. Someone like myself who's played the previous multiplayers since they came out, I just want either that kind of multiplayer to come back because it's really unique. And any multiplayer that's even similar to it now is because of AC multiplayer, because they've obviously made their own equivalent of it, but it still doesn't hit the right marks.
In terms of multiplayer, this could be Unity's version of multiplayer, this could be Black Flag's version of multiplayer, or both in a combined way, which is cool.
Mm-hmm.
Would love to play Assassin's Creed with you guys, with my friends. So it's not just going to be a solo experience. Only concern of mine is I hope they handle this well.
Well, that's something I don't think is going to be the case. I don't think it's going to be handled badly, because it's going to have its own dedicated team to it. I just think the presentation of what kind of multiplayer experience we're going to get is the thing that I'm concerned about. They could have told us anything. I feel like it's going to be not so much a PvP experience, which was one of the best aspects of the older ACs, because flawed as it was, it had tons of opportunities for improvement. I do feel like they could build off it and create that kind of setup again, all fresh, brand new, with a lot of new stuff, which is what I hope. That's my hopes. What about you, Red? The concept of it being a standalone?
Standalone? I'm on the fence with it, because like multiplayer was like one of the best things in the previous ACs, and I'm happy that it'll come back, but if I wasn't a big fan of the co-op in Unity, to be honest. Excited for sure, but don't know how it'll be when it releases.
So your hope is to bring back at least some form of classic multiplayer rather than a co-op experience?
Yeah, I would prefer it would be that than co-op.
Previous Assassin's Creed 2, Brotherhood, Revelations and Assassin's Creed 3 servers will soon be shut down, which is going to be a blow for a lot of people, including myself, because my favourite one is Assassin's Creed 3 to play. Revelations has the best maps. That's my own opinion. AC3 was the best experience for me. And for those who have been curious about the multiplayer, who have probably just started playing the older ones, probably on older consoles or even older systems, even on PC, are not going to be able to get to experience the multiplayer at all. Which also leads the fact that PS3 Black Flag, I'm surprised that's still going for multiplayer.
Yeah.
But then that makes me wonder how long is that going to last. But with the player base from the previous Assassin's Creeds, are they all going to move over to Black Flag? Which means, are we going to get a surge of players, temporarily or permanently, who want to still play the multiplayer, but the only version they can get their hands on is Black Flag? And I'm not going to lie, I've been playing some of the AC multiplayer recently, and I have noticed a lot of new faces. And I'm talking like lower than level 50 new. Every lobby, I've seen different people. So for me personally, I have been going back to Black Flag, and I am enjoying it at the moment. Especially now I get to play with new people and use old tricks that I used to do back in the day that you can't just do on veteran players, because they all know it. But I'm making the most of it whilst it's still buzzing. What are your thoughts on the servers shutting down for the previous Assassin's Creed, Adam?
Disappointed, because I was very interested in trying out the multiplayer for Brotherhood. But now that the fact that after all these years, now they decided to shut down the servers, I'm kind of disappointed.
What about you, Red?
I'm sad that they're shutting down the servers, because it means that it's really getting old. The AC multiplayer is really getting old. It kind of puts me like a slap in the face. But to be honest, yeah, I'm really disappointed they're shutting down the servers. Since, like Adam said, I started playing multiplayer on AC4, so I never got to try out the previous ones. And so, a bit sad about it. However, I like to think that if they're shutting down the servers, it may be because they'll release new multiplayer, so they'll need servers again. So, I'm kind of being optimistic about it.
Which was going to lead on to my next question, really, because I was going to say, with Invictus coming out, there's that hope now that, are they shutting down the servers because they're going to re-implement that version of multiplayer into the new multiplayer-only game?
Yeah. All I'm going to say about that is, if they implement it in Invictus, I'm more than happy and they're doing the right thing. But if they don't, they better bring something really good to compensate. So the stakes are pretty high.
Codename Red. A premium AC set in feudal Japan.
Ninja Assassin!
You play a powerful shinobi fantasy, and it's supposedly the future of Assassin's Creed's open world RPG games. What are your thoughts on the reveal itself, as well as your overall thoughts about it, Adam?
Both positive and negative.
All right, so what are your positives?
My positives are, finally, we are getting a game that is in feudal Japan, which has been asked for the past decade. It's going to be about ninjas, which is logical because ninjas operate the same way as assassins do, very similarly. They value stealth, and their headquarters tends to be outside of the city, kind of like assassins do as well. But in terms of negatives, I'm concerned over the fact that it is being made by the same team that made Assassin's Creed Odyssey and directed by Jonathan Dumont. And they say the future of Assassin's Creed RPG games, it better not be another huge world that barely has anything in it, where there's 105 side quests and I can barely remember any of them. I hope to God that's not the case. But I can only speculate at this point, because I have no idea what the game is going to be like. All we can do is just wait and see.
Okay, Red, what are your thoughts, pros and cons, on Codename Red?
Well, Codename Red, as for pros, well, first of all, like I said, Ninja Assassin, need I say less?
Oh, yeah.
You are interested in that.
I am very excited that I feel like they knew what they were doing when they announced it. Like, they knew we were waiting for it, they gave it to us, they're like, we know you want this, so let's have it. And, like, I'm gonna say that I enjoyed Odyssey. I think it's one of the better AC games. I will stand by it forever. The reveal trailer, well, teaser, really, I felt like the style and how the assassin showed up and everything, I really liked it, so if it follows the same art style and direction, I feel like I'm really gonna enjoy Codename Red.
For me, based on the trailer, I actually quite like the look of it. In terms of the phrasing of what they've said, how it's going to be the future of AC's open world RPG games, that the way they phrase that makes it sound like that's a separate entity. We might get other ACs that aren't RPG. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. The phrasing of that quote, like that.
Mirage is one of them.
Exactly.
Like there's going to be traditional narrative-driven games, and then there's going to be like
RPG versions. Yeah.
So I think they're trying to satisfy both types of fans, who are fans of the particular version, yeah, RPG games and old school. Both of you will be satisfied. That's what basically Ubisoft is saying.
Yeah. My only negative, if that is the case, my only negative to that is, for argument's sake, say if I didn't like RPGs and I wanted a feudal Japan game.
Yeah.
That'd be the only real negative, because I would want to play that game, but I can't because I may not like that type of game. But that's pure speculation at the moment. Well, we obviously don't know if that's the case, but I'm just going off how this was phrased.
Actually, speaking of cons about this, is that one thing I'm scared of is, for example, Mirage is a huge success, like sales, how the game is received and everything, and then Codename Red is like a huge failure, and then they decide to like put all the budget towards one part of the games, and open world just gets put behind with less budget, less good games after.
Yeah, they did it with Rogue because of they were trying to push Unity out with the new system, the new engine and everything. And yeah, they should have put all their focus into Rogue, because that, as far as I'm concerned, is partly a missed opportunity, but also underrated. The game, although yes, it's a copy and paste on many aspects, but it's not a bad game. It follows a decent formula and a decent storyline that fits in within the world and the lore, and they pretty much ignored it because they were releasing Unity at the same time. So a lot of people either got confused and didn't play that one because it's suddenly the old one.
Not to mention, that game was not released on PS4 until later.
Yeah, which was also another thing as well.
Also for me is that I felt like Rogue's story was much shorter than Unity or the main title games. Like, it was just like a little... Like a little spin-off with unfinished. Like, they could have much more possibilities inside the game if they put more effort to it.
Yeah, I agree. Codename HEXE. And it's not HEXE, because of the way it's spelled. This game is going to be set in 16th century Europe during the witch hunts. Reportedly, it's going to be the darkest Assassin's Creed game ever made. Red, what are your thoughts?
Well, I'm excited for like a whole different style genre of Assassin's Creed, especially since they said it was the darkest one. The thing I wonder about is that when they mean darkest, will it be like story-wise or gameplay-wise, like if it was going to be like gory with lots of horror into it?
I think they mean tonally.
Then
because the nature of the content.
Then I think it'll be a huge thumbs up for me for HEXE. Right now I think it's speculation because I did some research about like how people analyzed the trailer and everything. And some people managed to decipher the little writings in the symbol, if you see what I mean.
Yes.
The logo. And people mentioned that there was the name Mephisto in it, with like, and so maybe like the witchcraft is going to be part of it will be a huge part of the game.
I have my only speculation with the witch hunt side of stuff is I think someone's tampering with the first Civ technology that given 16th century communities are going to look at that like witchcraft.
Mm.
And I think that's partly what's going to be the case, because I mean, given the way the games have currently gone, it's easy enough to come to that conclusion, but I just don't know how that falls into an Assassin's Creed storyline. So I am curious, I am wondering how that's going to play out, and is this one going to be an RPG as well?
Dark Assassin's Creed, yeah, I'm definitely down for that.
I don't want it to be a horror. Mm-hmm. But I do like the idea of it being tonally darker. I mean, to give an example, the Vlad the Impaler mission in Revelations.
Yes.
It's tonally a much darker mission, but it's not a horror. We've got the Jack the Ripper DLC for Syndicate.
Which was also tonally dark compared to Syndicate.
And it has some dark material in it, like the way you could kill people. It was pretty savage when you're playing as Jack.
Yeah, when all the writing showed up on the screen when you were fighting and all. I really enjoyed that.
So it's that kind of stuff that I'm pretty much expecting from this. Obviously, full on. They're clearly making a point that this is what it's going to be like. So I do feel like it's going to give off Blair Witch vibes. This one is titled Other Projects. We're going to cover a couple of different things in this one. So we're going to go with Codename Jade first. The free-to-play open-world mobile game that's set in China, which has an assassin clearly in the trailer, but the game is set way before Origins. So that confuses me. Bayek and Aya were the ones that established the Brotherhood and the Creed and everything like that, and started their Brotherhoods.
And became universal with it.
Exactly. So the fact that they've created a character before all that is confusing. I don't understand why they've done that. Unless there's actually a legit reason in the game that can explain it. I do feel like it's just going to be a random free roam with like little quests here and there. There's nothing... I mean, the game looks good, surprisingly, for an open world phone game. I'll be playing it. I want to see what it's like. Are you guys going to get it?
Oh, yeah, I'll definitely be playing it off work. During work, excuse me.
For me, I'm not a big fan of mobile games. I never liked them a lot, so I'm kind of sad that they used this setting for ancient China and into a mobile game.
But the game does have a full parkour system, and you supposedly can scale the Great Wall of China. All right, on another topic, the Assassin's Creed Netflix series. Are you guys looking forward to that?
Oh, yes.
I'm more of a yes and no. Because, I'm excited that AC finally has another chance to prove that it can be good as a TV show or movie. The one thing I'm afraid of is that Netflix is involved.
Netflix does have a track record of releasing some good content.
Yeah, they have more than good content. They have really good stuff on Netflix. But the one thing I'm afraid of is, they have good content, but they also have pretty mediocre ones. And they also have a tendency to, cancel shows before they can reach their full potential.
It's always down to how it performs when they cancel. Because, that's how it always comes down to. If they can see from the start that it's not working, they'll do what they want with the show. I mean, they did it with the Resident Evil.
Yeah. So I'm excited for it, and I hope that it works.
For me, I'm particularly looking forward to it because I said from day one when the movie was on its way that it should have been a series. There's too much content to cover in a film. 50% of the movie I actually do enjoy in it, and all of that is the past sequences. Mm-hmm. It's the modern day that was really underwhelming for me, and it threw so much information at you. And even as a fan who knows what I'm looking at, anyone who I was sat with, I'd look to them and they have that confusion on their face because they're new to the franchise and this is supposed to bring them into it. And they're looking at it going, what the hell's going on? And when I'm having to explain stuff, that's when I know it's a bit of a screw up.
So if you're doing the job, the movie's job for them, then the movie's kind of failing in a way.
Yeah. I mean, the only one thing I didn't like about the past sequences was the reveal of the aerial assassination with its 14 different camera angles. And for some reason, Aguila is the most lightest man on the planet that it takes a whole 3 minutes to get to the ground. And then when he does land on the guy, it's so graceful. It's like there was no aggression to it. I mean, when I think of how it should look, the cinematics to the aerial assassinations in Revelations. Mm-hmm. When you'd leap off and Ezio just slams onto someone just when he's killing them, that's how I picture it, because it's a full grown man landing on another man. It needs mass and weight to it. Apart from that, I enjoyed it, but again, I felt like there was a lot of stuff rushed. Namely, once they found the piece of Eden in the end of the movie, it took them 5 minutes to go to that church and just grab it. They literally drove to the place. There was a cutscene for a moment that cut away, then the cut back, and they're walking out with the thing. You don't even see where they got it from. And I'm there thinking, well, was there no underground Isu temple? Was there nothing that we should know? You know what I mean? No, apparently it's just in the back.
No puzzle to solve.
Yeah, apparently it's just in the back.
The thing I'm wondering about the TV show is, do you think it'll connect to the lore established in the games, or will it be separate?
I think it'll connect to the games. Because, the movie connects to the games.
Oh, it's definitely connected. Well. If the movie is in Origins, but the Origins references the movie a lot, by the way. Definitely the television series.
Like I said, everything I genuinely enjoyed about it was all the past sequences. I thought it was really well shot and really well executed. I loved all the beam running, the parkour, the combat. Even the carriage fight, it gave me Revelations intro vibes. But yeah, the modern day was the thing that was let down because of pacing, and I feel that a TV show that can really spread that out, as long as they don't drag it out, I feel like we could get a real explanation in how this should all be established in a show, especially to bring in a new audience. And finally, there's an AC VR experience coming out called Nexus. As far as I can tell, in my mind, the way I picture it, it's going to be that sort of cliche. You're going to be sat in the Animus with someone standing over you, and you're going to be put through the rails. You're going to be one of the subjects.
I've never been fussed over VR games, to be honest. So,
me, I have VR, so I'm willing to give it a go. What are your thoughts on the VR, Red?
For the VR, I'm curious, but I'm also kind of scared of how it's gonna go. Like, if it's gonna have to, like, the wobbly physics while I'm doing an assassination. Alright, I can already picture myself just standing on my bed and just jumping down to do an aerial, just like in the, like, in the game. With the headset on.
He goes to stand on the edge of a building in the VR and literally jumps off thinking, I can do everything right now. But in actual fact, he just belly flops the floor in his living room. I'm going to say this now. If they do implement like building scaling in some way in the VR, one thing I can vouch for, because I played the Batman VR game, which is really good, by the way. It's so funny. There's a scene where I'm as Batman and I'm holding Penguin upside down on the edge of a building, and I'm not giving you like any crap. Like, I looked down and I was getting vertigo because I'm standing right on the edge of this building and it was so weird.
Oh god!
And the fact that the concept of like the kind of buildings you could potentially stand on in a VR experience for Assassin's Creed, with the concept that you might jump off.
Just throw up when you put your headset on.
Yeah, so that's where my curiosity comes from, because like the feeling that Batman gave me, because that game was well done, like it was really put together quite well, and it had some jump scares in it as well. But it does make me curious about how they're going to achieve an Assassin's Creed experience. But I do feel like it's going to start off with you being put in an ambulance. Alright, that pretty much covers everything. This is now the final thoughts section of the podcast. Anything you feel like we've missed, or anything you got any comments about, anything at all, you can say it all now.
As final thoughts, I feel like Ubisoft did a very good job for the showcase. Like, they had our hopes up, they haven't revealed too much, so I'm excited and hope that it continues down this path.
I couldn't agree more.
Don't be lazy. Give me more than that.
Yeah. Okay. In terms of Assassin's Creed Mirage, I definitely agree. I hope to God that is going to be the path that Ubisoft will take in regards to every project.
Or at least a path.
Mm-hmm. A path. At least a path. Like I said before, I am optimistic, but I am also cautious, because I have been disappointed before after watching epic trailers and having games that do not represent the trailer. We'll just have to wait and see.
One thing I'd like to add is in regards to Ubisoft, I feel like they're finally like approaching AC as the huge franchise that it is, like having its own showcase, a presentation and everything, so I'm happy that it's starting to get back into the mainstream a little bit.
For me, the overall experience I thought was really good. I mean, I agree with you, Red, that having Assassin's Creed be its own event was refreshing. Although, yeah, we only got snippets of stuff, it was refreshing that it was primarily about Assassin's Creed, which is nice for once, because every time we've ever had like game events, we would wait God knows how long for a 3-minute trailer, and then that would be it. That was the end of our wait, but people would continue watching, which is fine. They have other things they want to play, but having a whole segment which is dedicated to Assassin's Creed, and we got spoiled. They didn't have to tell us even half of that.
Yeah, they could have just announced Mirage and Infinity and They would just end there, but no, they went like, we're going full out.
Yeah, and what I find crazy about this is it's quite out of character with them as well, because they're usually so secretive about every game that will come out. So to know the next handful of games, I suppose it's quite refreshing for them. It keeps the pressure off, because people will know what's coming now.
Yeah, since people know like this, they have time to breathe and actually work on it and not just out of nowhere send a trailer and then say, don't worry, they'll be out soon, trust us.
Yeah, exactly. I will also give a shout out to the fact that they used the actor who voices Sean Hastings to be a host.
I appreciated that.
Yeah, that was nice touch. It felt familiar, and especially having a voice actor that's been with the franchise since day one.
Oh, yeah.
So that was a nice addition. Yeah, my overall gripe with it, I mean, I wasn't ever expecting any gameplay regarding Hexe, Invictus, Jade, Red, or more details on Infinity. But the fact that we got a full-fledged trailer that was primarily an Assassin's Creed trailer, not just referencing an aspect of Assassin's Creed, was a big win for me. So, I mean, as far as trailers go, massive thumbs up. I do think we should have got to see some gameplay regarding Mirage. And like I say, my only gripe was the fact that they're releasing pre-orders and we haven't seen gameplay. I'm not going to lie, I'm a sucker for the special editions because I love my statues, I love my collector's items, things like that.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at it thinking, I've got money for that. And all I'm waiting for is the gameplay. I want to see what I'm buying before I hit that pre-order button. Because I will, for that. Because I want to know that that's what I want. I didn't pre-order Valhalla or Odyssey because everything I've seen just wasn't pleasing me. And then luckily for me, everything I found out about it afterwards and even my own gameplay experience with all of them, I just didn't enjoy because it just wasn't for me. Everything took too long. I'm such a story-driven player that when I'm wanting to continue this story and I'm having to do all this extra stuff for no reason, it tired me out. I just couldn't be bothered with it. Origins I give a pass on because I don't see that as an RPG. It doesn't have RPG elements in terms of dialogue, so I don't have to do things that waste my time. Anyone who's gone back to it in recent times has realised that it's massively underrated. It's the best looking one of the trilogy by miles. Alright then, I would like to thank you, Red, and Punisher for attending this podcast.
It was a pleasure, and thank you for letting us participate.
Yep.
For those who have dropped messages to me directly to be shown in the video, Wingspan TT, I appreciate your involvement, even though you couldn't be here. To those who have stuck through the whole video, thank you so much for watching. If you like what you see, please drop a like. If you're new to my channel, please hit that subscribe button for more. Once again, thank you all so much for watching, and I'll definitely catch you on the next one.
Yes. Indeed.
See ya.
See you soon.